suis très contente de pouvoir tenir cette.
I'm very happy to be able to hold this third meeting of this cycle about port. We had named this cycle the stakes about problematics in port authorities and ports. We wanted to address three topics: the relationship between the port and the city. And Bernardo Secchi and Paolo Vigano came indeed to talk about this idea with the strategic plan of Anvers, on which they had worked, and then the very strong relationship between the port and industry. And tonight, to close this cycle on ports, we wanted to understand the port as a multimodal platform with the key links of a logistic chains under stress. And I'm very glad to welcome Paul Hamm. He is the General Director of Business Development of Europe Container Terminal in Rotterdam. And he's going to honor us with an intervention, and so that we can grasp the stake of the world logistic competition. I do thank you for coming from very far. Rotterdam is, of course, in the Netherlands, in the Rhine Delta. It's the first harbor in Europe, with 441 million tons processed in 2013. It has a considerable lead over European competitors, and the Rotterdam port is an industry and port area, very large, with which mixes urban spaces, industrial spaces, ports, businesses, and communication infrastructure. It's very interesting for us. The port of Rotterdam is a hub-type port for oil transport as for containers. It receives wares from the Middle East and Asia and will unload super tankers or giant container holders, and will load them again on smaller ships to forward the wares further. With this meeting tonight, we want to make you better understand these global operations, which do represent also the way we live on a day-to-day basis. We buy pencils, we buy coffee machines, washing machines, jeans and t-shirts, and all these goods are transported. You have to realize how much this this reality is really intricated in our daily lives. And if the planet has become one and only one because of globalization, the transport and flows of wares and appurtenances is tangible indicator for that. Describe territories in terms of hierarchies, of structures and clusters, of GNP, of unemployment rates is not enough to comprehend the reality. And we would like to add to a static vision, a dynamic vision, that of flows, of links, and add to critical masses a visibility of what mobility links can be, financial relationships, research and innovation links. All that makes the interdependence and the mutual contribution between territories, of course, in addition to competition. If you go beyond the usual vision of the power of territories seen as emanations of their peripheries, then you can start to see that we have gone to an operation of territories that function much more in network, where localizations center suburban areas are completely upset and completely turned around by the globalization and the evolution of our life ways. And it goes beyond the cities and intercity limits and operations and even metropolitan operations. In this world, linked world, we have new alliances built around common projects with at scales unusual for most of us, and which go very way beyond the administrative limits, and that can become a new modality of organization. It's also consistent with interdependent spatial systems, which go beyond these administrative scopes. And I'm saying this because, in fact, some authorities have been able to anticipate and to have a vision about that. The ports of the Upper Rhine have been able to work. We have this globalization context that entails such developments for the Rotterdam port that you have to organize a hinterland ports that are able to relay the forwarding of goods for Southern Europe and Eastern Europe. So more exactly, this hinterland is starting to structure itself around large platforms, which are really also hub-type platforms along the Rhine. The positioning, the situation of these hubs platforms and their connection with a road and rail network, an efficient network, will determine the structure of new logistics territories in Europe. For a large part. What are then the conditions for the nine ports of the Upper Rhine to take together a part of this role? That will be perhaps the an answer with the RTET, which is has been called by the European Commission for a networking and mutualization of alliances between these forces and minimization of risks. To the profit of their capacities, their savoir-faire, their knowledge in terms of import and exports on the territories which they serve, and also access to much to territories much more eastern in Europe. But all this is ongoing, which is why we asked to Paul Hahn to explain what logistics is all about, the supply chain and this world competition from the point of view of a very large operator situated in Rotterdam, but not only in Rotterdam, you will probably mention this. We are indeed very interested by the perspective of a very large deep-sea port actor, the organization of river territories, and also by the way you reason, the way you look at things, and your financial criteria, your economical criteria. We will then have a roundtable to understand this interaction with this type of logic with our local ports, such as Basel and Strasbourg, their anticipations, their development ambitions, their needs, the necessary alliances. As much as Strasbourg as for Basel, the relevance of the river as a transport means in the context of fossil fuels becoming scarce pushes us to think about upholding the port land use and to review the interrelationships between the several ports along the Rhine. Finally, our purpose is that in the light of this conference and the two former conferences in this cycle, you could better situate what this object port is all about. We know what a port is. We know that it's a sort of no man's land, landscapes in an urban context. But in fact, they house a much more complex and day-to-day reality, as this cliché would make you think.
My name is Paul Hamm. I work in Rotterdam for ECT. It's Container Stevedoring Company. I studied in Delft Technical University and also in the Erasmus University, and I'm working for more than 25 years now already in the port development, management, and project development business. I'm working for a company called ECT, European Container Terminals. It was founded in 1966. When the first container arrived from originally from the United States. In 2014, we did 7.7 million TEUs, and now I already have to become a little bit technical, because what is a TEU? When you look at the maritime business, you have two types, basically, of containers. You have a 20-foot container and a 40-foot container. So a 20-foot container is one TEU, and a 40-foot container is two TEUs. For people who don't know it, then if you now, from today, if you see a TEU, then you know what it is. So we handled 7.7 million TEU in the port of Rotterdam. I can tell you that's a lot of containers. And our main shareholder is Hutchison Port Holdings. Hutchison Port Holdings, that is a company worldwide. It's based in Hong Kong. The richest man in China, Mr. Li Ka-shing, has a company. It's called Hutchison Whampoa, and it has five divisions. One of them is ports, And the Port Division, we are also part of it. They are active in 52 ports all around the world. So that is quite quite a huge organization. So I'm working for a Chinese company. Although I'm not Chinese, and all the people in Rotterdam are working are just Dutch people. When I look at Rotterdam, this is the map of the Rotterdam harbor. Here's the city center of Rotterdam, and what you can see here is that this is the old port area, and that's where it's all started. These ports here, the harbors, they were constructed in the 20s and the 30s when there was a big unemployment in the Netherlands, actually in whole Europe. And with unemployed people, we started to create these harbors. And in the beginning, there was actually no customer. It was flat land. And but we expected, at least not me, but my grandparents, they expected here a lot of activities. And actually, they came. So it became quickly the biggest port in the world. And in the 60s, we started here our first terminal, and we handled here the first container. But then already the Port of Rotterdam said, or the Rotterdam community said, hey, if this is really growing, then we cannot cope anymore with the port here. We have to move all the way to the sea. And then the construction of the Maasvlakte here started. And that is reclaimed land. This was all sea area. Now it's industrial area, and it's all container terminals. but it took vision and courage at that time to start up there a huge investment called the Maasvlakte. And in 1984, we started our first terminal. That's the ECT Delta terminal. And 2-3 years ago, we started also the Euromax terminal. And when you have a look now, this is the second Maasvlakte here. It's a huge area. I will show you pictures. And it's all constructed for future growth. This is a picture of the old port area. Still here for us, 60 hectares with container traffic, but you can see also other activities. And I can tell you the city is closing in this area. So actually within, let's say, 10 or 20 years, this will all be gone, and this will be all constructed for, let's say, for the growth of the city. We still operate here a container terminal, but I can tell you not for the next two decades. Here we have the deep sea terminal at the Delta terminal. Almost 300 hectares. We have a key length of 4 kilometers, and we handle here the big vessels. It's a huge area. From this picture, you say, well, it's quite a big area, but I can tell you it's a massive piece of land. This is the next generation container terminal that we constructed. We are handling there now already 1.5 million containers each year. And that is incredible, because all those containers are filled with all kind of stuff that we buy every day. We also operate some terminals in the hinterland, like for example here in Straatsburg. We have a terminal in Duisburg, a big terminal. Also in Venlo. Venlo is located in the Netherlands, but it's close to the German border. We have a container terminal in Willebroek, that is in Belgium, near Antwerp. And also in one in Moerdijk. Moerdijk is not so famous, but it's a very interesting place. It's located exactly between the Port of Rotterdam and the Port of Antwerp. My speech of today, or for my presentation today, is about the rat race in the supply chain, because I can tell you it's a rat race. And why is it a rat race? I will tell you, because everyone wants his goods. He wants it faster, he wants it cheaper, and he wants it on time. And that is something that we all demand from the supply chain. So basically, we are the key drivers of the rat race. And that is an interesting thing, because we are living in a world of consumers, and basically everything that we buy in today comes from the global supply chain. When you go to a local food store, it must come from somewhere. If we buy fruit, it comes from, let's say, from Spain or from South America. It has been brought by reefers here. And then it must be brought into the shop. And if you start to shop in the morning at 8 o'clock, you want to have fresh goods in the shop and not from 3 days ago. Internet shopping. Everybody is doing it at the moment. You push the button at home and you want to have it the next day. But it must come from somewhere. And let's, for example, take a cost of a t-shirt. A t-shirt in the shop only costs 5 euros, even less. Now, there's an interesting movie, and you can find it on internet, on www.drisat.de. And you see a movie about this t-shirts, less than 5 euros, and what does it cost to bring those, what are the production costs, etc., of that t-shirt. And actually, it's not possible to do it for less than 5 euros. But still, companies make margin out of it. So it must come from somewhere. And when you see the cost of the raw material, that is cotton, and being plucked, picked from the field, is only 60 cents per t-shirt. That also includes the price of the wages of the people working there. Well, that is not my presentation of today, but they are definitely not the winners in the game. Production costs less than 1 euro. Transport costs less than 6 cents per t-shirt. And still, those 6 cents is not enough. It must be lower. That is the rat race in the supply chain. Now, for those 6 cents, what are we doing? First of all, of course, we have the transport cost of the t-shirts and the raw material, in this case in Bangladesh. We bring it to the port, it's being handled there, then it's going by ship all the way from Bangladesh to Europe. Then it's being transported either by truck or by barge, and it's going to, for example, to areas here nearby. Going into a distribution center, and there the container's opened. It's being unpacked, it's labeled, and then packed again. All the documentations needs to be done. The payments needs to be done. Custom clearance needs to be done. Then we bring it to the shop. And also insurance has to be paid, because sometimes accidents occur underway. And it's only 6 cents per t-shirt. Interesting. Now, and next thing, I will show you a short movie, and it's not about t-shirts, but that is about fruit that is being brought from South America also into our shops that we visit today. what you can see here, that it needs a lot of organization to do this efficiently and bring all those goods on time in the shop. And it looks easy, but in fact it's not. And the pressure on the lowest cost can only be done by a few things, by a few measurements that we have to take. And the first one is economies of scale. What you see is a vessel here, a container, the newest container vessels. They become bigger and bigger. And the only driving force behind it is to lower the slot cost on board of that vessel. The pressure on the supply chain presses all the carriers like Hapag-Lloyd, MSC, CMA, to buy these big ships, and it is an enormous investment. If you don't cooperate, if you don't play the game, you're out. So you have to invest in it. Even if you're a loss-making company, you have to invest in it. Another thing is, of course, massive investment in infrastructure. Old infrastructure is not interesting for the international companies. So what you're looking for is for places where the investments are well done. And that means that you can reach those areas by air, but also by truck, by rail, and by barge. Multimodal, full accessibility. And we have to invest in it. Another thing is the implementation of new technologies. I will tell you also a little bit about it later. Because the only way to lower the cost is to use those new technologies. And the fourth one is sustainable solutions. What we see, for example, also here in along the Rhine is the barges that are running not on diesel anymore, but on LNG. That is what the environment wants us to invest in. So the rat race in the supply chain needs a lot of investments. Otherwise, you're out of the race. This is an interesting picture. This is a ship, 2012, named the Marco Polo. It was by then the biggest container vessel. 16,000 TEUs on one vessel. I can tell you when I was working at ECT many years ago, there was a 6,000 TEU ship from Maersk. That was the biggest one. Everybody went out of the office because, wow, that was a big ship. 2012, the Marco Polo, 16,000 TEUs. McKinney Muller. 2013, already 18,000 TEUs on board, and it last week we had a ship from China Shipping. It's not on the picture here, but it's the China Shipping Globe, and it was already 19,000. And we know that the container vessels with 20,000 are already under construction, and the container vessels with 24,000 TEUs on one vessel are on the drawing table. And we expect them to be there in 2016. And that is a strange thing to happen, because it costs a lot of money. And the interesting thing is also that there are some places in the world where we still ship one container on a vessel with 7 people on board. Economies of scale. What we see is not only the container vessels are becoming bigger, but when they enter a port, the coal sizes, and that is the amount of containers that must be loaded and discharged, is also increasing. We had this year, we had a container vessel from Evergreen that was for the first time loading and discharging in one call 10,000 containers. And last week we had the first one that tipped over the 11,000. So you say, that's nice, but you have to stack all those containers somewhere. It's not that you must place them. They must be, they come from the hinterland, and you need places and also equipment to deal with these flows. So it's not only the ship, but the whole supply chain changes with these kind of vessels. So, economies of scale, but also investment in infrastructure. When you see in port investments, these big vessels, for example, they have a length of more than 400 meters. Now, let's say the Delta terminal, that is the big terminal that we built in 1980 or whatever. That was on the first terminal on the Maasvlakte. Still, the big vessels are coming there. We never thought that these mega vessels would come there. So we have to change and invest also in our existing facilities. I can tell you that the cranes that we are working now, they have, because when you look at the vessel, there are rows of 24 containers on board, so you have to reach with your crane 24 wide. The first vessels that we came in, there were 16, 17. And even every year we have to expand it or buy new cranes. We have to buy new cranes again to handle these big vessels. Also, the key walls must be bigger because if there's a, let's say, a big storm, these vessels must stay on the quay. And I can tell you there's a lot of force to keep that vessel on the quay wall. Terminal investment, I told you about cranes, but also in the logistics. It also means something in the hinterland. And it also means something actually here in Straatsburg or, for example, in Basel. Because these massive investments and enlargements of scales in the transport also has its influences on how it's organized in the hinterland. Here you see in Rotterdam, automated terminals. That is the Delta terminal. We don't do that anymore with people carrying around with goods, but we have fully automated vehicles to deal with these container flows. This is the Maasvlakte area. I told you, I showed you a picture before. This is, I think, in 2012. That was the newly reclaimed land. 3,000 hectares extra. It's reclaimed land of the sea. And it's now under development. And there are a few terminals coming on stream here. This is the new Rotterdam World Gateway terminal. And it is the APM2 terminal. 4 million extra capacity in the port of Rotterdam, only to deal with the container flows, of the flows of goods that come from China to Europe. It costs a lot of money, by the way. It's not something that you do, you say, well, I have some extra spare money, where shall I put it to? I think the whole Maasvlakte 2 area, without the investments of the terminal itself, it was 2 billion euros. So it's a massive investment of the port of Rotterdam and also of the state. But it's also made to make Rotterdam fit for the future. Hinterland. What we do is on average 100,000 containers a week. Now, if I start, let's say, building a wall of containers and I start in Rotterdam with 100,000 containers, then I end up in Austria. And that is what we do every week. That's quite a lot. And therefore, we need not only 30C deep sea calls, but also 22,000 trucks are coming in and going out the port of Rotterdam every day. 120 train calls and almost 500 barges. Last week, we had a new record. We did only in the ECT in Rotterdam, almost 110,000 containers in 1 week. And that is an interesting thing, because we all hear, hey, there's an economic crisis, the economy isn't working anymore, still we are doing 100,000 containers a week, and it's all stuff that we buy or export. So if the economy doesn't work, there is still a lot of buying power and still a lot of things that can be bought every day. In order to do something with, in order to construct the second Maasvlakte, we all had a modal split target because the environmentalists, they didn't like, of course, 22,000 trucks on the road every day. So they said, okay, we agree with the construction of the Maasvlakte, but the road, the modal split, the road must be less than 50%, so it must be go down to 35%. We must do a lot more with barging, 45%, and a lot more with train. And when I, for example, look with the barging, 1.7 million TEUs now, it has to go to 7 million TEUs. Now, that is interesting, so we can buy a lot of extra barges, but they have to enter somewhere in the hinterland, and there you have, you need also a lot of investments in ports to handle these cargo flows. Synchromodal transport. That is something that we invented, I don't want to say, but that is something that we, a kind of a concept that we try to establish at the moment. And what does that mean, synchromodal transport? That means that we do not choose anymore of or compete between barge and rail and truck. We need all the modalities at the same time to deal with these container flows. And I have a small...
European Gateway Services by ECT presents Synchromodality. Some things may seem chaotic, but are in fact very well organized. Transportation of goods can seem chaotic too, but with synchromodality based upon volume and scale, logistics are completely under control. Every barrier is parried, thanks to the optimal use of all modalities. It's all about making the right choices at the right moment to meet the client's needs. That's how synchromodality makes our and your business competitive and sustainable. European Gateway Services. Straight into Europe.
Yeah. Well, it's an, a small movie, but it gives a little bit an idea of what we think, how we should organize the transport chain. The large coal sizes, for example, but you said 18,000 TEUs ships, they enter Europe, and I can tell you they don't call every port in Europe. They go to maximum three, and then they go back. So that means, let's say, in every port, 12,000 TEUs loading and discharging. And it is not future, because I already told you yesterday already, or last week, we had an Evergreen vessel coming in with 11,000 containers loading and discharging. It puts a lot of pressure, as I told you, on the container terminal itself, but also on the whole transportation system. And that is why we say, hey, we want to utilize, let's say, all modalities in the network at the same time. Improve also the reliability of the network. That's very important. We cannot cope with a train connection that runs on Monday, but it doesn't run on Tuesday. It has to go, let's say, every day at least one train and a barge. And we want to make the choice ourselves on what on what modality we want to transport it. Because if you want it tomorrow, you better put it perhaps on a truck or on a train. But if it can wait 3 days, then you even can put it on a barge. And I can tell you that sounds logical, but it's not the way it goes now. There are companies who reserve places on a train to move the containers inland, and there it stays for 14 days. And containers that needs to be transported immediately, there is no space for. So we have to reorganize the whole transport chain. And it benefits us all. It benefits the shipper, at least, because it's flexible. It lowers the cost, because you can choose the best the best modality that fits in with the transportation requirements. And also, it fits in with the sustainability, because a lot of shippers, like Coca-Cola, Nike, or whatever, IKEA, they want to transport it green, and they don't want to transport it anymore only with a truck. So they explicitly ask us to do it by barge or by rail to the hinterland, and even perhaps in the future other modalities. It benefits also for the service providers. Those are the logistic service providers that need to do the business for their clients. So that is, for example, Panalpina, companies like Kuhn and Nagel. They book on the different modalities in our system. And of course also for the authorities and the citizens, because nobody wants to have 22,000 trucks running around every day in his backyard. But that is an important thing. You cannot have your consumer goods in your home without trucks or whatever, without noise. There must be something that we call it always not in my backyard syndrome, but if you want to buy goods, you need to accept a fact that sometimes a port or a road is constructed, and that's the only way to get your things in your in the shops and in your house. Now, I told you a little bit about our concept straight into Europe, European Gateway Services. Well, the picture shows, I think, clearly what it means. And it has a few trends. The price, of course, we have to lower the price. Personally, I think transport cost is already low enough, but the market in which we operate thinks it can still be lowered. Every year, the big transportation of companies need to answer to the tender, for example, the IKEA or whatever. They tender every year the transport, and they choose most of the time simple, it's very simple, the cheapest way. So every year again, everybody starts to tender, and we try to lower the cost a little bit more. Speed, the transit time reduction, well, that is, I think, a very clear thing. Some goods can have, let's say, 14 weeks or even more on a vessel. That's not a problem. But most of the goods we want to have in the shop today. And especially cargo that how do you call it, for actions or whatever, I don't know the companies, to be honest, here in the area, but let's say an action company that wants to have the goods tomorrow in the shop because it's a 40% discount or whatever, you want to have it today. And therefore you have to choose between the modalities. On time, at ease, you do not want to have a lot of companies in the transport chain. You have to deal with only one port, one door where you can enter and say, hey, I want to have my goods there. And of course, environmental friendly. Rail, barge, feeder, that is of course between the ports in Europe, overseas, and by truck. A little bit like a metro line, and that is what we offer today. There are more companies who offered it, by the way. That is not bad at all. But if you want to transport your goods, you want to pick up, and you basically what you say is, well, if I don't get this metro line, I will get the next one. And that is that. Then the system improves itself, because if you have one, it's easier to go from 3 round trips per day to 4 than from 0 to 1. So if you have 3 round trips, you go to 4th and the 5th, and then it becomes bigger. Now, there are also some interesting future developments who are perhaps a little bit influencing this picture. New technologies. What we see, for example, is here we call it platooning. And it means that the first truck, there's a driver in it, and the second and the third automatically follows the first one. It sounds future, but it's already existing. These systems exist, and they actually do a pilot now on public roads to check if this is feasible, and also to work out the law must also permit it, of course. They do a pilot, for example, in the Netherlands. I don't know whether they do pilots here in with these systems in France, but in the Netherlands we do. And there is still a driver in the second one, but actually he is doing nothing. So the second truck is just simply following the first one. And you can easily enlarge the system, and then you have a train of trucks going on the road. I wonder, when you look at, for example, how difficult it is to do transport of containers by train. It looks simple, but it's quite a complicated project. This is very easy. In 10 years, we will have these trains also running here in France. I'm convinced of that. It's very cost effective. But you say, for example, the fuel cost is still the same, but it's not the case, because these trucks are 3 meters behind each other, and then the consuming of the diesel is a lot less. This is not it's already there. 3D printing, also interesting. A couple of years ago, nobody heard of 3D printing. Now it's already there. Perhaps you cannot print everything with a 3D printer, but you can do a lot. And it's also developing very fast. So I am sure that 3D printing will affect the whole supply chain that we know nowadays enormously. Oh, automation and robotization. This will be the decade of the robotization, and whether we like it or not, it will come, because you cannot step out of this rat race. So robotization will be there, and if that's there, then we call it nearshoring. That means that we will not produce our things in China anymore, but we can produce our things again here in France, or what you see here, for example, in Poland. And that is already the case. A lot of production facilities are being constructed here in the European, East European countries. But in 10 years, I think a lot of those production facilities will come back here. And practically nobody is working in the factory anymore, but you don't have to source it anymore from China. Now, that will affect the supply chain enormously. But then again, and that is, I think, very important also, for example, for regions like Basel and Strasbourg, if you have the right infrastructure, and if you are connected to other areas in the world and other ports, then those are the facilities, or those are the places where the companies will go. Because you will, if you have to choose the place for your factory, then you want to know, hey, where can I get my rough material from? Then you want to be connected to Rotterdam. You want to be connected to Hamburg. You want to be connected to the Mediterranean ports. And then you have your facilities, your factories, actually working here. Now, whether this will be true, we will see. Because I don't know it either, and you don't know it. But it's changing rapidly. And yeah, the question is, of course, are you a winner or a loser? Well, that is interesting, but if you don't compete, then you're out of the game. So my advice is, be part of it and be smart. So if you do the right investments, you will be part of the rat race in the supply chain, also in the future.